gospel bridge has been erected to present hope for humanity. The strength of the bridge is in its planks and are a representation of the doctrines of the church. The stability of the American family is dependent upon this bridge of hope. While Hollywood invades our home and computers replace our parents, the church deludes its doctrine to a message of compromise. The devil and his demons have attacked the church through Marxism, communism, and Satanism. His grip has caused wars, violence, and death. But his greatest tool of destruction is not a polished pentagram, but a pointless pulpit. You may not find today's demons in black hooded robes, clothed in blood, and smelling like death. But rather you'll see them wearing Armani suits and Liz Claiborne dresses, filled with the stench of Escalade, all while standing behind the sacred desk. Today's preachers have watered down the gospel, traded doctrine for demise. Under demonic influence, these six-foot icicles have allowed Satan to steal the planks. But their delusion does not stop there. The demonic host have convinced preachers to replace the planks of truth with planks of compromise. Here comes one now, a pompous preacher with a pair of seducing spears. He's traded his pulpit for Playboy. His extracurricular activities have allowed him the time to get to know his secretaries. He's traded his wife at 40 for 220s. His message has no power, while his head is lying in the lap of Delilah. Now here's one. This preacher looks normal. He has a good home, a nice car with all the benefits, but his messages must first pass the test, and the examiners, Mr. and Mrs. Big Bucks. Oh, his preaching is good, but it cannot contain anything that would offend Mr. and Mrs. Big Bucks, lest they would leave his church and take their money with them. His preaching is filled with positive thinking, a doctrine that says each person can solve their problems by self-help, secular humanism. Of course, he does not believe in the blood, nor preach about the cross. It's not applicable to today's modern church. His message is an attempt to keep everyone happy, and the devil believes he's doing a good job. Now, here comes one, another preacher. He's so prim and proper. His unbalanced view of God portrays him as a loving father who does not need to send anyone to hell. In fact, he doesn't believe in hell at all. It may offend someone in his church. His plank is full of religious tradition. What about the electric evangelist who has his tape series, 7 ways to improve your self-image, or steps to success? His message is not to proclaim truth, but to present emotional stimuli that will tickle your ears and empty your pocketbook. His plan is a doctrine of self-seeking sermons. Doesn't this one look casual and comfortable? He preaches in a seeker-friendly church. His message is, come as you are, everyone is welcome here. His church is so casual that even his sermons cannot be more than 15 minutes or everyone would fall asleep. Is this what's happening to our churches today? Is everyone so comfortable they're slowly falling asleep? Without doctrine and service, what will happen to this generation? Where are all the fathers? This father has heard many sermons, but not doctrine. The message has been matched void of conviction and filled with compromise. He's not the priest of his home. His son has been raised by a computer and reared by television. Oh, but now he's late for his tea time. He's in a hurry. He's got to go. His buddies are waiting for him. But look, the bridge he's on is not a bridge of hope, but a false hope. Lured by evil spirits, he's on a road to destruction. Now his wife. She has no time to be a mother. Why, she jogs in the morning, goes to Christian aerobics for lunch, visits the tanning booth before dinner, and stops at the gym in the evening. She's a church and preaches no doctrine. So she runs towards a path of deception that the devil enjoys her company. Bridge of falsehood has secured another. The son indulges himself in the world of the web. What was supposed to educate and entertain him taught him how to create bombs and to shoot to kill. His friend tries endlessly, pleading with him to accept Jesus. But his response is, I go to church. Religion has replaced relationship. Confused, lonely, and empty, the devil lures him down his parents' path to the highway of false hope. Struggling to find his way, he now notices the bridge is without doctrine and it's insecure. Fear grips his heart, and he remembers the pleading and the prodding from his friends from school. Suddenly, from the bowels of hell, a hand appears and offers him his answer. Gathered around the flag are a few remnant warriors claiming this generation for Jesus. But in a fit of anger, he lashes out at his world and shoots with rage. For a brief moment, he feels remorse for his actions, but is quickly silenced with an empty conscience without conviction. How did this boy get to this point? His parents did not bring Christ to their homes because conviction was not in the sermons. What message were they hearing? They were hearing a message without hope. Who is going to save this generation? Where have all the preachers gone? Who will declare the doctrine to the church? Who will help us repair the breach?
Bishop T.D. James called me just a few hours ago the Lord had stirred his heart. And for me to tell you, you're in the right place at the right time. And you're about to hear the right message. I want to say thank you to all the World Harvest Church Ministerial Fellowship Council members, to the elders of this church, to its ministers, to its leadership, to my family. Because God is man. With righteous indignation, he looks toward what we commonly refer to as the church. I have never been more acutely aware of why it's taken me 22 years.
Thank you.
Just to be somebody, the minister of all preaching.
Been so long since we've seen one. We don't really even know what that one looks like. But I can tell you one thing, the greatest ones in this nation, those guys, these guys, all over the place, most of you have never heard of any, have seen somewhere for 100 people, have seen somewhere for 200 people, have seen somewhere for 500 people, and everybody knows the name, the great God of Christ, the souls of humanity. You're
Jesus, we will stand on our I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to get me the socioeconomic tables of several cities before I decide where I'm going to go past. I need to know what is the cost of living. How many days the sunshine they need. You ain't got no words. Let me tell you. This is the way you preach to the congregation. You don't want to get it. You don't want to accept Jesus. You don't want to get into the voice of Christ. You plant your feet. You lift up your hands. And you talk. Because I've heard God say to me, don't be afraid. And the reason he has said that, because all of me was smiling. I saw what I had. I saw the intent of my answer. I heard his thoughts pray. I heard Jesus. I felt a lot better. He wasn't like you, evangelist. Some of you can't pay your bills for being on the phone begging somebody to let you come preach. Whatever happened to the Bible saying a man should give it made room for? You should make room for you to get out of here. I see you again. So you can tell that there must be a lot of churches there. So evangelist Paul will certainly increase his mailing list there. He will make sure that the pastor will let him have the names off the offering so that he can then bear the people in the mail to increase his. He will surely at the pastor's conference get a second dose of cards to hand out. Have to get on national television and get it.
So much was done in so little time when Christ was the Savior. When it wasn't me and my ministry, it was Him and His ministry. When it wasn't my word and my plan and my program and my intellect, it was all Him and none of me. Oh, how rapidly the thousands would be. That first planet. It goes around the sun in 88 days. It only takes Mercury 88 days. What it takes the Earth, 365 days. But it takes Pluto. You know why? Because it's so far from the center. Mercury, the wing-footed planet, Mercury, over 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit on the surface, burning and boiling. Mercury, because it's close to the center, but then you get out to the Earth and it's a little cooler out there. If we were close
closer to the sun, we'd burn up. If we were further from the sun, we would be frozen to death. When you get all the way out there to Pluto, it's just a little frozen ball of gases, and ain't nothing can live out there because it's too far removed from the center. Can I tell you something? The church has gotten so far removed from Jesus that it takes 3,000 church members one full year to win one person to Jesus. But I got news for you. We're getting closer to His return. And the closer we get to Him, the faster things are going to happen. The faster the healings, the faster the deliverance, the faster. What took me 22 years to build, some of you are going to build in 22 months. What it takes them 22 months to build, some of you are going to build in 2 days. God. I told you I was just going to hit it and skip. I got a question for you, preacher. Where are you drifting? Used to feel the need of Him before you mounted a pulpit till you had to go in the bathroom, toss your cookies, your nerves crawling all over you, your palms sweating, your heart palpitating. You recognize the awesome inability of yourself and at the same time the grandeur of His ability in you. Oh, if you could just get God to come. If you could just get God to pick up your body like Gideon and put you on. If God could just clothe Himself with you. One word would shake a million demons from helpless humanity. Oh, do you remember? Oh, but you got everything you need now. You already got a crowd. You got a good PA system now. You done moved uptown. You ain't having to bleed for your bread no more. You've manipulated a bunch of big bucks in your congregation to the point that they're taking real good care of you. As you stand there and command the people to tithe, and you don't. I'm preaching. Beautiful excuse for preaching. But I found out revolution means another thing. It means, watch me now. I wish I could forget about time. Watch me now. Watch me. It means you were here when you started. And a revolution means you got to come all the way back to where you started. You got to get that childlike faith back. You got to get that utter dependency back. You got to get that God. If you don't give me a word to say, I ain't got nothing to say. You got to tear up all your sermon notes and throw them away and start all over again. You got to get back in your prayer chamber and start all over again. You got to throw everybody else's tapes away, including your own, and just start all over again, bare and raw. Just get back where you were. And if we can get the preacher back where he was, we can get the church back where it was. Somebody shout for me. I can't see. See, I didn't come in here to deliver a sermon. I came in here to deliver a baby. I'm trying to. was on an airplane, the Holy Ghost came to me. God had brought to bear upon me the weight of my assignment. Let me tell you a thing. If all I want to do is get a crowd, I've been around. I know how to get a crowd. I can get a crowd. I can teach you how to get a crowd. But I don't want a crowd. I don't care nothing about a crowd. We got too many folk looking for a crowd. Loving the crowd and hating the people. We've got too many. I don't want that. Take it all. Take it all and give me Jesus. I have decided I'm going to follow Jesus. I don't need your Wall Street marketing experts. I want to follow Jesus. I want to say what he tells me to say. I don't want to preach for results. It's your problem. You're always preaching for results. And it's making you drift off track. God never called you to preach for results. God called you to say what he told you to say, when he told you to say it, how he told you to say it, to whom he told you to say it. Results are none of your business. Jesus didn't say, I'll go to the cross if. He said, my father told me to climb up on this beam, and that's exactly what I want to do. He went into on that beam and into a tomb, and they sealed him in. And the world said he was wrong. And you can't stand it unless somebody comes up and strokes you about how good your sermon was. Everybody thought he had failed. He looked like a failure. But he said, I'm going to the cross. I'll leave the results to my Father. And you know what you need to do? You need to go to the pulpit like it was a cross. You need to preach like a dying man to dying men. You need to preach like there is no tomorrow. You need to preach like that's your last opportunity. Somebody's going to hell if you don't stop. And if it makes the crowds come, that's nothing to you. And if everybody leaves, that's nothing to you. You preach his word and leave the results to him. Got to get back. There is much to be gained by return to the discarded values of the past. Now I'm going to give you in the next 15 minutes what has shaken my life as it has never been shaken in 22 years. I was preaching in a major auditorium, 10,000 people in attendance. I was preaching from a very familiar text. John chapter 14, verses 1 to 3. You believe in God, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house were many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. And I go to prepare a place for you. That where, and if I go, I will return again and receive you unto myself. That where I am, there you may be also. was shot. Dance. Run in the aisle. Until I went to preaching. What that text meant. I went to preaching. When two will be in the field, one taken, one left. Two will be grinding at the mill, one taken, one left. I started preaching about a place called heaven. I was preaching about these old folks and the underpinnings had all gone out of them, and their silvery hair, their gray, their raven black hairs turned silvery gray, and their skin no longer taut on their face. And I talked about that there was going to come a time when they would leap like a hart over the everlasting hills of God to suffer no more, to cry no more, to sigh no more, to die no more. I was trying to preach about the blessed hope. Started looking in their purses for minutes. They cut me off. You know why? Because all they've had for 20 years is a self-help gospel of humanism that deals in the merchandise of the temporalness of this present world. This me gospel. Me, my house, me, my gifts, me, my children, me, my marriage, me. We have taken the infinite eternity and reduced the gospel to some philosophic, psychological self-help program in a temporal preacher stopped me afterwards. You don't really believe that, do you? Believe what? Well, you don't really believe like streets of gold and stuff. Oh, no. Yeah, see, you frown, but if I told you their name, most of you support him every month. But you don't know what he preaches. You never bothered to pay any attention. He's so busy helping you feel better about yourself that you have no earthly idea that he drinks 3 bottles of wine at dinner. Come on. And called himself a bishop. Bishop. Somebody said to me the other day, this bishop so-and-so. I said, bishop of what? Bishop of what? What are you the bishop of? Are you the bishop, the husband of one wife? That bishop? Are you the bishop that rules his house well and has his children under subjection? Are you that bishop? Are you that bishop that's not given to wine? Are you that bishop? Are you that bishop that's apt to teach? Are you that bishop? Are you that bishop that's given to hospitality? Are you that bishop? Are you that bishop that has a good report of them without? Are you that bishop? Are you the bishop that has a good report of them within? Are you the bishop that 1st and 2nd Timothy and the book of Titus talk about? I'd like to meet you. But if you're just some bishop, I had a man offend me from a national publishing house sitting in my own office, coming around courting me. We'd like to give you a $50,000 check, Pastor Parsley. Little advancement here. Like for you to write a book for us. But now what we need to do, see, what we need to do is you need to drop this pastor thing. See, we need to get you another title. Let me tell you my title. Preacher! I'm a preacher. I'm a preacher, a bona fide, dyed in the wool, Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized, fire breathing preacher of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And don't you degrade my office by telling me I need some other type.
But most of you, that has stroked your ego. Speak, oh yeah, that's what I believe. Brother, elder, bishop, reverend, doctor. Sit down. This is my meeting. I'll preach as long as I want to. I preach till he says quit. Come on now. Now you excuse me, but I'm a preacher. I am the medium upon which the heart of God breaks into language. And through it, the purpose of the infinite is made to be heard, and all the indignation which is proper to its outrage. I'm a preacher. Don't have no time to trifle with you about silly questions that gender strife, dealing in the merchandise of this temporal cursed planet. Don't tell me the thing's not cursed. If it wasn't cursed, God wouldn't have to burn it up. And he's already told you he's going to burn it up. So y'all go ahead and get it in the best shape you can, because the Holy Ghost is about to light a match to the whole business. Well, you know, we don't want to be so heavenly minded. We're no earthly good. Now, excuse me, we can take this out of the table. That's just plumb stupid. You can't be so heavenly minded that you're no earthly good. Because the greater glimpse you get of that other world, the more good you want to do to get somebody out of this mess and over there. Preaching. Hear me preach. Turn me off. Didn't want to hear nothing about heaven. Didn't want to hear nothing about no rapture. Set up on Christian TV and say we are the preachers of a new millennium. We have no business mentioning the subject of sin. I don't guess you want anybody to mention it. Sitting in a hotel watching Playboy and drinking Budweiser. I don't guess you do want anybody to mention it. Well, now, he ought not talk like that. He ought not talk about the brethren. They ain't my brethren. No, you miss something. You miss something. I don't have to belong to your little ecumenical boys club. I could care less whether you ever invite me to preach or not. Pay my way. You don't believe the blood, you're not my brother. You don't believe the cross, you're not my brother. You don't believe in holiness, you're not my brother. You don't believe in straight and narrow, you're not my brother. You don't believe in heaven, you're not my brother. You don't believe in hell, you're not my brother. Jesus said, I'll remind you, he that is not for us is against us. Which is proper to the outrage of God himself. I'm making me preachers in here all over the place that is popping like popcorn. I'm making me some preachers. Here it is. Here it is. I said, God. What's going on? And God said, we have replaced. You know what a lot of churches, they don't even put the pulpit in the center anymore. Put it over there on the side. And when you move that preacher out of there and you've replaced him with something else, you're lost. You're lost. God's. Here's what's happened. We're living among a people that if somebody gets on Christian television and says there's no rapture, people sit and applaud. If I go back the next night and preach on the rapture, the same people will sit in the same seats and... You know why? And I'm only using the rapture as one example. You know why? Because they don't know nothing. Now I'm going to fix you. They don't know nothing. Does anybody remember in a return to the discarded values of the past, we're like the Athenians, Paul said, you're always running about trying to know some new thing. What's your revelation? What's your deep revelation? What's your new thing? What's your revelation? What's... And most of it not revelation at all. It was too much pizza before they went to bed. It's not a revelation. Some crazy thing. Prominent doctrine going around right now that John 14 doesn't really mean heaven, that heaven is just figurative, that actually we can't understand God, so we're just going to move into the being of God. Whatever God is, that's what we're going to become, and we don't really know what it is. So there are really no streets of gold, and there are really no mansions. Let me tell you something. Ira Stanford said it best. I don't know about you, but just over the hillside, in that bright land where we'll never grow up, and someday yonder we'll never more wander but walk on streets that are paved, made of gold. Mansions will glisten on the hillsides of glory. Happy reunion on streets made of gold. Angel choir singing, glad praises forever. But Jesus will outshine them. Sit down. Sit down. Sit down. Does anybody remember in a return to the discarded values of the past, in a revolution to get back where we started, does anybody remember, am I the only one that ever went to something they called Sunday school? Anybody ever go to Sunday school? Let me refresh your memory. Stanky church basement. Bird egg blue paint on the concrete cinder block wall. Does anybody remember Sunday school? Does anybody remember Sister Gillicutt? Sister Gillicutt, who had not learned yet that they had made undergarments for the upper hemisphere of the female anatomy. Sister Gillicutt, she got that waddle down there hanging down about 14 inches. Just Sister Gillicutt. Does anybody remember Sister Gillicutt? Does anybody remember a light blue flannel graph? Now, Sister Gillicutt, she didn't wear her dress up about 14 inches above her knee. No. Sister Gillicutt, she didn't go to tanning bed. No. Sister Gillicutt, you couldn't call her on Saturday night on the gossip line, because she is busy getting her Sunday school quarterly ready, because she had three snot-nosed kids in there the next day, and it was her responsibility to teach them the gospel.
Sister Gillicuddy. Sit down. Sister Gillicuddy. She didn't run around talking about her ministry. No. She just had some scrawny little kid, more knees and elbows than anything else. One of that hillbilly bunch of Parsleys down yonder underneath the church in the basement. And it was her responsibility to teach me Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego. She made me memorize. You know why? I know. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I go to prepare a place for you. If I go away, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. You know where I learned that. Sister Gillicuddy! Yeah. People ask me, well, how do you quote all that stuff? Well, I didn't start yesterday. What university? Brother Parsley. What seminary did you graduate from? Gillicuddy. I went to Gillicuddy. I graduated with honors from Gillicuddy. Sister Gillicuddy. And you didn't call her nothing but Sister Gillicuddy neither. Because she would teach you discipline, and she would teach you how to act in the house of God, and she would teach you respect for authority, respect for God, respect for His word, respect for His man, respect for His church. Sister Gillicuddy. Doing my short sermon tonight. I got some long ones the next 2 weeks. We don't have Sister Gillicuddy no more. No, because we can't find none. We can't find nobody willing to go sit in the church basement and talk to the Rod Parsleys of the next generation. We can't find one. They all too busy with their notepads and tape series. No, so we can't have that no more. Now we got something called Junior Church. And we replace Sister Gillicuddy with Blues and Bozo the Clown and Foo Foo the Dog. And the problem is our children don't know. We didn't have no Blues. No, sir. We didn't have no Blues. At Easter time, my daddy had a ping pong table in the basement made out of a sheet of 4x8 plywood set up on some saw benches. Put a net on it, called it a ping pong table. And every Easter time, my mother and the church ladies would all get around that ping pong table and take baggies and make us a treat for Easter time. That's the only day Sister Gillicuddy would let anything interrupt her class. See, she's on an assignment. She was going to make a preacher that would preach to 97% of the households of America and 78% of the households of Canada and 300 nations of the world. She had to make her a preacher. Now, don't go out of here and say, well, Pastor Parsley said, what are you saying if we use blue? No, I didn't say that. I'm trying to show you what's happened. Ain't nobody making your children learn memory verses. They in there shooting water balloons and having a good time. They ain't learning nothing. They think the epistles, the wives, and the apostles, they don't know nothing.
I heard one of them say the other day they'd read the Bible from Job to Malachi. They don't know the Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments, most of you don't know the Ten Commandments. Most preachers don't know that one about adultery. They've missed that one. They're lying. How many you got in your church? 42,000. How many you see? 12. Wait a minute now. Wait a minute now. Wait. You'd have to have 192 services a day. I come to preach for you, and then you take your offering and receive mine, and then shave yours off top of mine. Ain't nobody in America brave enough to talk like this. You know what I learned in youth group? I'm a product of one of the greatest youth groups in the world. You know what we learned in the youth group? How to praise God, how to pray, and how to witness. That's all. We didn't have no video games. Didn't have many. We got our fun out imposing the kingdom. Yeah. You know what? I tried all that stuff. I tried all that stuff. You know what happened? The good kids started acting like the bad kids. I said, wait a minute, there's something wrong with this. This is going the wrong way. Oh, we had nearly 2,000 kids in there. And I told them to shut the thing down. I'd rather have 200 that knew how to get a hold of God as 2,000 coming in there looking after some girl to go date in the back of the church and get her pregnant. You don't understand what I'm talking about. Now, I'm not saying that in and of themselves any of those things are wrong. But what we've done, we've replaced the preacher. We've replaced doctrine. So our kids don't know nothing. Our young people don't know nothing. And in music, oh, you don't want me to go there. No, you don't want me to talk about music. Every song we sing, we are. How about some stuff like, when I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but loss and pour contempt on all my pride. How about at the cross, where I first saw the light and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I'm happy all the day. How about amazing grace? How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost and now I'm found. I was blind and now I see. How about some with some teeth in it? How about my sin? Can you imagine having a contemporary gospel song about my sin? Oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not just part but the whole, is nailed to his cross and I bear it no more. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. When peace, like a river, attendeth my way. When sorrows, like sea billows, roll. Whatever my lot. Oh, that'd go over good preaching today. Whatever my lot. You don't even know where that song came from. A great missionary on a boat with his family to a foreign land. The boat caught fire and capsized and was sinking. Holding on to a piece of driftwood as he heard his daughter and wife burning to death inside that boat. Held on to a piece.
piece of driftwood. And in his mind began to write those words. It is well. It is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be summoned. And the clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The Lord shall descend. The trumpet shall sound. Even so, it is well with my soul. I got to bring it around now. I got to bring it around now. You excuse me because I'm possessed. I didn't say it to be funny. I'm possessed. God, I said, God has gone too far. We'll never get it back. God said, the results are not your responsibility. You say what I told you to say, when I tell you to say it, to whom I tell you to say it, and you leave the results to me. And I got to believe that in every generation, God's had a remnant. I've got to believe he's still got an Elijah and Elisha. He's still got a Shadrach, a Meshach, and Abednego. He's still got 3,000 that have not yet bowed their knee to Baal. Sit down. Here's the worst indictment of all. When Christian television first began, there were no Christian stations to speak of. There was ABC, NBC, CBS. Most folks had rabbit ears, and you had to actually get up from the sofa to go change the channel. And on Sunday morning, Sunday night, or Sunday morning from 7 in the morning till noon, you tune across any of those stations and you'd find a preacher calling America out of its sin-sick condition. But that went by the wayside. Largely used as a tool of evangelism in its infancy, Christian television then gave us celebrity. Now you see, you have to understand with your spirit tonight, because I have a youth program that has video games. We have junior church. We have music. This ministry's on television. I'm just telling you what God said to me. All of a sudden, with the celebrity, came a desire to keep the crowd. And so we translated preaching away and replaced it largely with the fivefold ministry office gift of teaching Christians. But we had to be careful because our audience was so much broader that people that believed in the Trinity dare not preach it on television, lest some folks that didn't believe in the Trinity stop supporting their ministry. You see, you don't know what most Christian ministers with any form of what you would deal in as success, you really don't even know what they believe. because most of them won't tell you. Maybe they don't believe in the Trinity, but they won't tell you. When's the last time you heard a good message on sin? Wait a minute. Most of them are Pentecostal. Most of them have in their doctrine the baptism of the Holy Spirit. When's the last time you heard one of them preach on the baptism of the Holy Spirit or pray over television for people to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit? When's the last time? You can't name it. You can't name it. We have reduced, understandably so, we have reduced what is projected through the camera in our celebrity to the masses to spiritual pablum. I heard one on the other day telling us how to put our shopping carts back. Marriage seminar after marriage seminar. How come you got to take Holy Ghost filled, fire baptized believers and have marriage seminars? What? That's elementary. Why do we have to teach you how to pray? Nobody taught the Christians in the book of Acts how to pray. See, now you're getting mad at me. Now you're starting to turn me off. No, because you don't understand. The preacher does not deal in the merchandise of the surface and extremities. The gospel preacher puts his hand on the heart of humanity and announces, this is my mission. If I get the heart right, I get your heart right, you won't be coveting my wife. I get your heart right, I won't have to teach you how to give. I get your heart right, I won't have to teach you how to be healed. I get your heart right, I won't have to teach you how to pray. We're dealing on the surface because we're afraid to dive into the heart of the matter and be as Samuel and stand up in front of Israel and say, as a lone man standing on a mountain, pointing his finger at a nation and a church and simply saying, you are wrong. Dear God in heaven, Larry King invites preachers on to talk about a man in the highest secular office in the free world who has little enough self-control than to take an intern into the Oval Office and have oral sex. And you know what the preacher said? Well, we need to exercise forgiveness. Well, I ain't heard him repent yet. No, he said he was sorry. That don't have anything to do with repentance. But don't blame Mr. Clinton. The man, when he was 9 years old, tucked a Bible under his arm and walked for 2 miles and asked God if he should go into the gospel ministry. And when he met with his pastor said, I think you ought to ascribe to a higher call. His pastor, who was a Marxist. He was raised listening to a preacher preaching eternal security and telling him, if you were saved and you committed an act in your flesh, it had nothing to do with the eternal salvation of your spirit. That is Gnosticism, and it is a plague in the body of Christ. What if he had had a preacher, a medium upon which the heart of God broke into language? What if he'd had a preacher that told him the highest calling in the world to use his God-given charisma for would be to put a microphone in one hand and a Bible in the other and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ? What if he'd had a man that told him oral sex outside of marriage is no different than intercourse outside of marriage? It is sin. It is adultery. It is an abomination before God. But the problem was he had no preacher.
And then the ones that ought to know something set up on Larry King. Well, we ought to get, we ought to just be forgiving. And, you know, the gospel is just forgiving. It's just forgiving. It's just forgiving. Where was a prophet? Where was a voice? Now, let me tell you what we've done. Let me tell you what we've done. We have equated being on television with success. Now I'm going to stagger this entire crowd. And if I had my sense about me, I'd never say it. But I didn't come. I don't have the opportunity to say what I'd like to say. I'm under a covenant. I'm a preacher. Let me tell you what it takes to be on TV. See, when I go to ABC or any Christian station, they never have one time asked me if I was anointed. They never have one time asked me if I was called. They never one time asked me, did I have a word from God? They never one time asked me what my personal morals were. What my personal life was like. You know the only thing they asked me? Can you pay the bill? Show me the money. I can go on as many stations right now as I can pay for. I could spend $10 million next week and not bat an eye. And would nobody ask me if I loved my wife? So everybody pays his bill, then they get on TV. And then when they get on TV, now here's the tragedy. If you don't hear anything else tonight, and I know I've said a lot, if you don't hear anything else tonight, hear this. The tragedy is that we think that it's that will win America. Now I got to tell you a thing. The people up there have an assignment. But you better hear me. Every church person in this building, hear me. Stand up, Pastor Harrison. Stand up, Pastor. Stand up. Give me some air. Stand up. Stand up, Pastor Trice. Stand up, Cal. Stand up. Do you see men? Where do you pastor?
Atlanta.
Edmonton, Alberta.
Texas.
Kentucky.
Kansas City.
Huntington, West Virginia.
Norman, Oklahoma.
Let me show you something. I want everybody to hear me, and I want to put this on national television. Don't you cut it out. I am not the guardian of your soul. These men are the guardians of your soul. These men. They are your pastors, and God intends to do everything he does through the apostolic authority of the local church in this hour. These are the guardians of your soul. Be seated. The tragedy is this. And I promised God I'd say it if he gave me the opportunity. We sit and we watch that. And because as a local pastor we equate that with success, we think we have to preach the same kind of sermons that they preach. And since they ain't preaching nothing but pablum and ear-tickling philosophies and vain deceits, then you turn around and preach what they preach. First of all, that would be wrong if everything they were preaching is right, because that assignment is different. I do not preach to this church the way that I'll preach in Huntington, West Virginia. This is my church. I'm the guardian of their souls. I'm responsible before God. I have to preach doctrine. I have to preach eternal judgment. I have to preach repentance from dead works. I have to preach on baptisms. I have to preach on end time. I have to preach on holiness. This assignment is different. Under God, be a man of God. Your number one assignment is to get along with God and receive a message in secret that He declares through you in public. Your number one assignment is not to watch somebody and try to imitate and try to emulate what they say. Your number one assignment is to walk out into the presence of the people with a thus saith the Spirit of the Lord. And you want to be a preacher. You want to weep? Do you want your heart to break into a million pieces? Your family to forsake you and your friends to turn their backs on you? Do you want to be misunderstood and laughed at? You want the newspapers in your city to write your accolades or flaming missiles? Do you want to be a preacher? If you can do anything else and live, do it. I beg you. Sell cars. Sell real estate. Be a banker. Go into politics. Do anything. But if you're not called under God, don't do this. Everybody stand. Days, and we embark into a new millennium. But the message has never changed. Soul that sinneth, it shall die. Do you go to bed hearing them? Do they wake you? Does the thought of their perishing make you walk the floor? Or is the gospel just a business to you? Just a way to pay your bills? God calls some preachers tonight. Call some men of bravery to stand up and point the way. Oh, there's so much that I have to tell you. I wish I had you for 30 days, not just 3.
they know about eternal judgment? Or do you dare never mention that? Are you preaching for results? I preached in a church not long ago, and I'm gonna share this with you. Then maybe the Holy Ghost will let me go. This particular preacher thanked me. They said, weeping, I used to preach like that. But then I started getting invited to a lot of big meetings. And they said, you know, if you preach that popular message that's so trite and so trivial, those thousands of people scream and they clap and they laugh and they jump and they run. And they said, this preacher said, it's intoxicating knowing that they like you like that. And weeping, they said, pray with me that I'll preach the truth again, because it's so hard. I want to make you a promise. I've made it to you before. If I can't preach what God tells me to preach, they can take me off every station, and I'll stand right here in this pulpit and preach. Does it matter? I'm not going to compromise. Now there is room for teaching to the body of Christ. And there is room for all sorts of ministry. But if you really look, everybody seems to have gone the same way. How about a good message on holiness? How about a good message on Moses gave you letters of divorcement because of the hardness of your heart, but I give you no such levity. But I say unto you that if a man look upon a woman to lust after her, has committed adultery in his heart. Boy, wouldn't that go over big on Christian TV? You see how far we've come. People almost laugh when a man says, I've been married to this woman for 42 years. I hear you, doctor. He wants me to tell you, it's not hard to live right. It's not hard to love God with all your heart. Let's come out from among them. Let's be separate. Let's be men of God. Oh, thank God. Thank God for the Kim Copelands. Thank God for the Bishop T.D. Jakes. Thank God. Thank God. Oh, God. Give us a few preachers. Give us a few.
He's not calling you to be like anybody. Because nobody can do what you can do. Whoever he's given you to be the guardian of their soul, would you sell out for them tonight? Would you say, Lord, if I never mount a platform with more than 500 people in attendance, I'll be faithful to you. I'll say what you want me to say. I'll say it in love. But God, I'll say what you want me to say. I'll hear your voice. I'll speak your word. And I'll leave the results up to you. He calls ministers to be fishers of men. That's not a call to luxury. It's a call to toil, to labor, to sacrifice, to pain. He is no shepherd who sends the sheep out to test the waters, but an hireling and no lover of the sheep.
If I'm Samuel and Eli's house, you can hear me. And you can still hear the voice of God. And I want to testify tonight that whatever he tells me to say, I'll say it to whom he tells me and when he tells me. Walk out.